What's going on, fam? This is KR Jones of the Off the Strength podcast, and I am here to tell you to like, listen, subscribe, and if you're feeling freaky, visit offthestrength.com. That's where you can go and get more information on us. That's where we can link, we can build, we can connect, and let's make this thing work.
I need to put myself in the best position possible to live a longer lifestyle because you just don't know. And it made me want to help other people. I love Harlem, and I'm trying to figure out a way to obviously be successful and give back at the same time. It was just an eye-opener for me, and he was one of the main supporters when I started out in Riverbank State Park doing my boot camps with five people religiously every Saturday. He was there. And he's like, you're on to something. Like, I really enjoy being out here with you. I'm passionate about what you're doing. You need to figure this out and go forward with it. When I quit, I'm like, it's showtime.
Yeah.
It's showtime. And I'm exhausted as much as I can. And if it fails, cool, I can get another finance job. But, like, I'm giving this 200%. What's good, everybody? What's good? Welcome back to yet another episode of Off the Strength. We're giving you the inside look into all things wellness culture. I'm a trainer called Tony, and of course, with me, I got a gentleman of extraordinary league.
KR Jones is in the building.
That's right, folks. We are back. And ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, you are now in store for a treat. Ain't that right, Brother Jones?
You goddamn right, man. Back to back to back.
Again, we bringing the friends to the show. Now, I have to say, before we go any further, the most deepest heartfelt apology to this brother over here, because this man is supposed to be on this show probably like a good 4 or 5 times by now. And y'all, I gotta tell you, man, the first time I had to reschedule, I did not anticipate this being the reason as why we needed to move. I was like, I wanted to be here, I swear. Everything I wanted to do that damn Friday got interrupted by the Monday of me getting hit by this damn van, man. So that was one. And then I had family shit and all types of other stuff. But long story made less long, this brother has been somebody that I have watched from afar. When we first had a chance to meet, I was like, oh man, this is the brother who's been getting people doing all these kettlebell swings uptown. He got black people turning kettlebells. I ain't seen that in a long time. It was gear of sport, all the Russians and all the rest of that
being
stuff.
Black.
You That's what I was about to say.
The
you know?
Kettle calling.
No, I ain't it's even. The kettle calling. I see where you was going with it.
The kettle calling then, black.
I see him up there, and then he was getting up with Tamika. You know, Tamika Rochester has been on the show. I was like, damn, man, we ain't even get this brother on here yet. I see him with Tamika. Now I seen him with the homie Q. I was like, damn, he out there with Q too and the whole Uptown crew. Bro, we got to make some noise in here for Ja Washington one time, man. Make some noise for this brother.
Appreciate it.
Because I'm finally here saying thank you for coming through. And it wasn't going to be anything that stopped me from coming here today, bro. Promise you that.
Much appreciated.
And, yeah,
I mean, you know, things happen. You know,
yo, multiple times, bro.
Is way more important than us getting on this. I knew we were going to get it done at some point.
It was going to happen.
Got to take care of yourself first, bro.
Hell yeah, man. So, yo, Ja, there might be some people out there that don't understand what I just finished talking about, how you got uptown doing a whole different type of motion going on, man. And I seen you moving. I seen you training. You're getting people all kind of inspired, man. People might not know the full glory. Ain't that right, Brother Jones?
They damn sure don't.
We got a couple new people, the lay people out there. We got to explain to them what's going on in these fitness streets and NYC and abroad now. So could you start it off a little something like this for me, brother? Can you let people know who you are? Where you from, and then we're going to jump into your story.
So, Jakeem Washington. Most people know me by Ja. Ja Holla, if you grew up in Harlem. 36 years old, born and raised in Harlem. Grew up playing a lot of sports, was an athlete. Went to school in Connecticut 4 years. Economics, human development major. Worked in finance for 9 years. 2016, quit my job to be an entrepreneur. Got into fitness, found a knack for it, really enjoyed it, and you know, really wanted to help my community and found this to be one way to kind of jump into that and be supportive outside of a number of other things No, I'm just a guy in the community that loves his people. I love Harlem, and I'm trying to figure out a way to obviously be successful and give back at the same time. And I'm trying to figure out a number of different ways to do that. And again, you know, health and wellness has been number one and super important to me.
Man, all about that. Uptown.
Yeah, yeah.
You know them uptown vibes,
Uptown,
man.
Baby.
Gotta get in there, man. You know, where are we going to take this after, Jones?
I mean, you kind of sprinkled it out a little bit, but we're going to take you back, right? We're going to take you back to the beginning. You told us about Harlem, but the way we started off is, where were you when you fell in love with this thing we call wellness?
Where was I? I mean, so I've always been an athlete. So being in shape has always been an importance. Not as much now as it was then, or vice versa, rather. Much more important now. Just more knowledgeable. Things are more important that I didn't really take seriously or just didn't have the education on. But for me, everything happened for me in 2013. So I had started training. First I got in terrible shape. Let's just say that after college, started working a 9-to-5, you know, really partying, going out. Again, having a great time and spending money, not really worrying about nutrition and stuff like that. I had dedicated a lot of time to sports and athletics for 4 years. And so when I graduated, I just wanted some downtime to cool out. So got in some really bad shape, got myself out of that shape and started feeling really good. A couple of friends asked me to support them on their journeys. So this is kind of my entry into fitness. Helped them lose a bunch of weight, in particular two clients, 90 pounds and 60 pounds down within a year. So that was a big deal for me. That was like my start of like, okay, this is something that I might be able to, you know, do some things with. But in August of 2013, one of my best friends, while at a basketball game, had a heart attack. Mm-hmm. And he passed away that day. And that was a trigger for me because he was in tip-top shape, a triathlon completed. He finished that. One of the most athletic guys I know, played high school basketball with him. And him having a heart attack didn't make sense to me. It just blew my mind. And so it made me really hone in on like, okay, you know what? I need to put myself in the best position possible to live a longer lifestyle because you just don't know. And it made me want to help other people, you know? So one friend of mine, she was triggered by it, another close friend. And that's how she started her fitness journey. And she's the one that lost the 90 pounds in a year. She saw what happened to him. She never really paid attention to her health and wellness. And she was, you know, 300 some pounds. And that really triggered her. Like, I need to figure this out. So between her wanting to get it together and coming to me specifically in that situation, it was just an eye opener for me. And he was one of the main supporters when I started out in Riverbank State Park doing my boot camps with five people religiously every Saturday. He was there. And he's like, you're on to something. Like, I really enjoy being out here with you. I'm passionate about what you're doing. You need to figure this out and go forward with it. And, you know, well, he's looking down at me now, but he didn't get a chance to be here and just watch this stuff grow and build. But every time I do something, I do think about that and it keeps me motivated.
Man, first of all, just condolences for the loss. You know, I see that has empowered you to do a lot since then, you know, to start with five people from the early inception to know people could check out what you're doing now. And I mean, I always knew that there was a deep passion behind what you were doing. I couldn't really understand where that was coming from. And it's the same thing is true for a lot of the people that, you know, you cross paths with in this industry. There's some people, Ja, who just show up and they want to do it for reasons that are not going to be as directly tied to community, mm-hmm. and that are directly tied to the empowerment and the proliferation of people. But I saw that was something that was true from the very beginning when we crossed paths. I was like, okay, this brother's moving for a different reason. Yes, he's getting people into crazy, phenomenal shape, but it's about a much bigger part of the story. When did that start to become clear to you?
So I was a 4-year starting point guard in college. I played basketball in high school. So now, you know, I'm thinking about all these things that I was doing, bringing people together, dealing with different egos and personalities, but we're all, I'm getting them on the same page to get to a common goal. So I love that aspect of sports. And I love that community aspect. Like, I don't have a ton of family, not really family oriented person. Mm-hmm. So I have a ton of friends. And so for them, that's family and that's community. And I really love that environment. So I've kind of taken a little bits and pieces of even in finance, you know, with my job was sort of sales and tech blended. Again, a lot of conversations and meetings and talking to people. So I got into a good groove in terms of like bringing people together and creating something that everybody is energetic and passionate about. So with the community stuff, you know, particularly in Harlem, you know, growing up, I didn't see fitness wasn't important. Health and wellness wasn't really a thing, or it wasn't something that people like really dove into and looked into, right? I ate McDonald's all the time. I ate fast food all the time. There wasn't really any healthy options unless like my mom cooked. And when she cooked, she's from down south. So she was throwing down.
Hey, man.
Right?
It was love. It wasn't healthy.
That's what I'm saying.
I would love to have some of that later on, actually. But, you know, but again, the priorities weren't there in terms of like, there wasn't the knowledge. It wasn't the education. And so when I got the opportunity to build something, I started thinking about these things that I didn't get a chance to take advantage of. From a fitness standpoint, as an athlete growing up, I really didn't have anywhere to train. So I was always relying on the same movements, push-ups and pull-ups and dips, and I just played. But like when I got to college, you know, when you look at these guys who are coming from all over the place, they're already weightlifting. They've already been doing all sorts of drills. They had strength coaches in high school. I couldn't take advantage of none of that, so they already had the upper hand. And quite frankly, like I feel like, you know, that's just kind of how it's been for minorities in general. There's always like, we have to do a little bit more
with
to
less.
Get ahead, right? With less all the time. And we kill it, but it's just unfortunate that we have to do that. So for me, it's just, you know, wanting to kind of bridge a gap and do whatever I could. So fitness became one way to build a community, get people together, health, wellness, but also now I got a community that's a network, right? It became bigger than fitness. Everyone is coming together to, hey, I'm going to JTW Fit to see my friends, to hang out, right? But I'm also getting in shape. There's like a little spin on it. Versus like, oh, here we go. I got to go to this Saturday morning boot camp because I know I need to get up and work out, you know, knowing you don't want to. Became less tedious, more habit, and just fun. And building that, that's where the success comes. You know, everything else out of that becomes a lot easier when you got the people that just want to be there.
Yeah, man. You established the culture for it. I swear, when you were saying you was playing ball, I was like, oh, okay, he's running back, DB, something like that. This dude said point guard. That's scary stuff on the other side of that point.
You
guard.
Already know.
I was about to say, I don't want to see the screen. I don't want to see it. I'll be on the side.
defensive prowess, you know, up in your ass the whole time, every day long, you know. So, you know, that was fun, though. That was my pastime. That's what I did to release stress. It was the only thing I loved doing. It's what helped me, you know, do well in school because I just really wanted to play. So, I lean on sports as, you know, it's been something that's super important and it's guided me the whole way.
I think about, Tone knows, I played sports too my whole life and we always get into that basketball conversation, which we're not going to get into right now. But the thing that I think about most is I truly believe being a point guard is way more than just the act of, right? Because as a point guard, you're the general on the floor. You know what I mean? Like everything has to run through you. And not only that, but you have to create opportunities for other people, right? Which can directly tie into something that you're doing today, like career-wise. It's like, as a point guard, yeah, I can score, but it ain't about me. Like, how can I get the ball in the post? How can I get my man on the wing activated? You know what I mean? Like, how can I break down this defense or this problem that I have in front of me and score and win a game ultimately? And I think those kind of things get lost in sports a lot of times and people don't realize, like, that's what a value is. Like, yeah, this game is cool, but I can take this and put it into real life and real action and build that community, you know? So I can only appreciate a point guard in here, you know what I mean? And we got to play ball one day, Tone, and you got to be there to referee.
You know? That's what I was about to say. You know, the way that this foot is set up on the sideline, yeah. I'll keep all the score.
Of course.
Well, I've been looking to come out of retirement, so let me know. I'm definitely down.
Most definitely.
I like it.
Now, also, you spoke about being into the finance and tech world, which I think is also closely related to the fitness industry. Like, when you think about, we're not that far from computers at the end of the day. Like, it's a bunch of ones and zeros we got. And, you know, how did that transition take place? Like, was there a moment of like, you know what, I'm tired of this. I want to go into my passion? Or was it, you know, something that kind of drew you into it?
So funny thing, so fitness wasn't my passion. I enjoy being in shape. I do like to look good, but it wasn't something I was really wanted to do. Growing up, I wanted to be an architect. I got to college. I at one point wanted to be a teacher. Gradually started to talk to advisors and see what everybody else was doing. And all of a sudden, finance became like the thing. I'm like, I'm tired of being broke. I don't want my mom to be broke. I'm going to go figure out how to make some money. And I was like, I'm going into finance. And what I'll do is, on the back end, I'll do all the community work. I'll do all the education stuff. I'll still make it part of my life, but it just won't be how I make my money. And so I wanted to make sure, because I'm like, I need to make sure everybody's good first. And so that's when I started going into the schools into my high school in particular to talk about entrepreneurship, finance, and just different directions that you can go outside of the same old need to be a doctor, need to be a lawyer, need to be a teacher. But being in finance was amazing the first like 5 years. I was learning a lot. I was making good money. I was happy. And then it got monotonous. It got boring. You know, the raises and bonuses weren't really, it didn't matter. The money didn't really matter. Money has never made me happy, but I knew I could do more. And so I was like, yeah, this isn't it. And I had started training maybe 2012 and just a hobby, you know, a couple of friends like we talked about until we started the boot camps on Saturdays. And then 5 people became 8, became 10, became 15. And then I'm like, So now, you know, I got a couple PT clients from it. So I started doing a little bit of math and I'm like, well, I could probably quit this job, maybe, right? But I was also nervous, so it took me a bit. And, you know, so then fast forward, I meet my girlfriend and she's sitting with me and she sees how passionate I am. She's talking to me and she's like, quit. And I'm looking at her like, what? She's like, just quit. And so in my head, I'm like, I don't know any woman that's going to tell a man to quit this full-time job, make some money, to go like
black
venture
woman
out.
That, you know what I'm saying?
Venture out and just like try this thing. She's like, the energy that you put into this, when you come home, you don't talk about work. You talk about who you train. You never bring up work. Or when you do, you're pissed off about it. She's like, let's run the numbers. Let's sit down and talk and think about what you're making, what you need to do to move forward. And we did the math and she's like, oh, you got to quit now.
Wow.
You know, and I never did the numbers really. I just felt like, you know, I think I could do this, but the numbers with the projections. And then I'm like, well, what do you do for a living? Because I really didn't really pay attention to it. So we get into that conversation. She helps small businesses to get financing, grow, build, you know, projections.
And be your own people, right?
And so I'm looking at her like, you know, but it was a blessing and a gift without me. But it wasn't why I dated her, which I also love, because I was like, well, I don't know. I guess you were put here for a reason. And so, like, yeah, I'm quitting. You know, so I went in, put that 2 weeks in, and whew, after that, sky's the limit. I literally got home and had nothing else to focus on. And so now that 2 clients became 8, and then I just got to the social media and started promoting and pushing, you know, this Harlem Hit situation that we had. And it's scary because the amount of success that we had so quickly, I was at home, like, this doesn't make sense. Like, freaking out. I don't even know how to deal with the demand that's coming in. You know, I don't know how to price this. Everything's new. You know, the studio we were in is super small, but we got 10, 15 people on the wait list. So we're trying to figure out how to, like, get everybody in there. So, you know, a good problem. But, you know, had she not come around, I probably would have quit. It would have been, I think, too late.
Too late to catch the wave of success that would come.
Yeah, everything happened. It was just spot on. Like, it was supposed to happen at this time. You know, even in, like, subletting my apartment, because I was like, I need to cut back on costs. So, you know, I got a sublet. I moved in with her. You know, that happened when I needed it. I was like, I need like 2 or 3 more clients. All of a sudden, I get like 2, 3 emails. I get the clients that I need. So now I've got some money for the cushion that I needed for that 6-month, you know, 12-month period. Just things were working out. And I was like, okay, you know, this is freaking me out a bit because nothing happens like this. But, you know, just like, yo, good energy. You love it. You're passionate about it. Like, the world knows that you need to be doing this. And they're presenting you with the options and you just got to make the right decision.
And when did it become, like, solidified for you? Because I hear that process is happening and it's happening fairly rapid, right? You start off as, here's my thought, here's my idea. Oh, wait, hold on. I'm putting out really good quality product. I'm seeing that return, you know, starts from the inception of that idea. People are giving you accolades and they're seeing you make these things happen and they're celebrating you. But when did it really click into your mind that it was like, okay, wait, hold on. This is bigger than maybe even I initially thought it could get. And how did you handle that? And where'd you go with that after?
So one thing about me, if I say I'm going to do something, it's happening.
Yeah.
I at least have to commit to it. And if it doesn't work out, cool. But like, I'm never going to look in your eyes and say, hey, I'll be there. I'll do this and not show up. So when I quit, I'm like, it's showtime.
Yeah.
You know, it is showtime. And I'm going to exhaust as much as I can. And if it fails, cool, I can get another finance job. But like, I'm giving this 200%. So once we started, my partner and I, Thomas, we started Harlem Hit. So that was our first studio, 117th and Madison. We partnered with the Physical Therapy of Harlem. they gave us one of their pediatric facilities that they weren't utilizing. And we started out with $10 classes. So, you know, basically went with like a, I guess like a Planet Fitness model. Rather than try to have a high price, let's get a low price. Let's just get people in front of us. Make sure it's quality. Make sure that we know what we're doing and we're giving them a really good session. And it's just going to be super inexpensive and affordable. And so we took that route, again, just to get people in, let them see what we're doing. The studio was, we had a red carpet. We had like a whole dresser thing coming out in the middle of the space. It didn't look the part at all, right? So it was hard to get people to be like, you know, what is this? This is not like, you know, same downtown. And we're like, you know, trust us. We know what we're doing. We had six kettlebells, six med balls, a couple other dumbbells. We just like making it work.
Yeah.
But just kept grinding it out. And people were like, yo, I love this. I love it. So now I'm like, okay, well, tell your friends. Bring a friend for free. I don't care. Just bring anybody. Get them in here because let them see what's going on. After that, I was like, you know what? I started doing like a social media thing. So I'm like, Instagram is big right now. I'm just going to, every time somebody comes in, we're going to take a picture of them in front of the logo. We're going to tag them so that they can repost it.
Man.
Just simple stuff. And then again, out of nowhere, we started in 2016. 2017, I don't know what happened, but towards the end of the year, all of a sudden, just I woke up one day and it was like 18 people signed up, 20 people signed up. I had two Saturday morning classes, 24 people, both classes capacity. And I don't know, I don't remember exactly what day or when it happened, but I just was like, oh, okay. And then everybody's like, yo, I need to come here. One, I need to take a picture in front of the logo because they just want to be down. But also they're just like, yo, I love the energy here. I love how positive you guys are. I love how there's so many shapes and sizes in the room, right? You guys don't discriminate. It's not intimidating. And the work is hard. And if I can't do something, you push me to do it or you give me something else to do, but you never make me feel like I shouldn't be here. And that was a big deal.
Man, I want you just to unpack a couple parts of that because you leaned into it a little bit towards the end, making people feel like they needed to be there. And then one of the initial comments that you said, this is not downtown. I know exactly what you mean by that, but there might be some people at home that don't really understand what the distinctions are and why you serving your community, you had to have a different approach to do that.
Oh, man. So a couple things. So I worked in a few gyms and I've bounced around a few gyms just like looking around, trying to figure out what everyone else is doing and also what I don't want to do and look like. So what I would see is, yeah, everyone is welcome. You can sign up, but you know, they don't necessarily look like you, right? They're not people of color. If you go to particular gyms, you know, no hate on CrossFit, but everyone is ripped and shredded. And so if it's my first day, probably not going there, you know, just not, you know, because again, I just don't feel comfortable at all. And it's really not the environment. It's, you know, it's a little cultish, I think, personal opinion. The other part is, again, how you look and feel. So if I go into a room and I see a woman who's getting after it that looks like me, I'm more inclined to be like, you know what? I might try a class here, right? I got so many DMs, and one of the best DMs I've ever received was to a really thin girl who comes to class, and she saw a larger woman doing like an agility drill, and she saw one girl look like her that couldn't do it, but the bigger girl was killing it. I mean, fast feet. But then when we got to the strength portion of the workout, she's looking at some other stuff. And the thinner girl is super strong. She's back squatting. And then the larger woman, she couldn't squat. So it was for her, she's like, wow. Like she thought it would have been flipped or reversed. So she's like, this is dope. Like, I feel like I can come here. There's not gonna be any sort of judgment. Like all the egos are out the door, because I don't play that. Like, we come in, this is a family, it's love. None of the catty stuff. We're not looking each other up and down. I'm treating you all exactly the same. I'm gonna talk junk. I'm gonna troll you a little bit. We're gonna have fun together.
That's a part of it.
You know?
Yeah,
and
I love it.
And again, and now that's the environment. So it's very motivational and everybody just wants to be there. They love being around each other. So all that stuff has just been, you know, you can't make it up. You can't recreate it. It just came naturally.
Hey, yo, come on home with us, man. Harlem World, USA, man. Take a walk with us on our block, man. See how we live. Dipset, yo, come on home with me. Early night.
You quench the thirst that people didn't know they had. And that's why they keep coming back, right? It's like, until people are exposed to something that they've never experienced, they don't even know it exists. Yep. And you talked about things working out. when they like having no clue how it worked out. And there's like a divine alignment, you know, when things kind of happen. I'm thinking about this chart. I don't know the origin. I feel like it's like a Japanese kind of chart, but it's like a Venn diagram with those four circles. And it has, you know, what do I love? What I'm good at? What can I get paid for? And what does the world need? Right. And all of these four categories, you just kind of fill up. Right. So it's like in between what I love and what I'm good at is my passion. In between what I'm good at and what I can get paid for is the job. In between what I can get paid for and what the world needs is like you just kind of filling up all these different spaces. But in the middle is that divine alignment, you know, when everything kind of comes together and that's what you're in. You know what I mean? And that's when the people that come into your life just kind of continue to fuel that as long as you tap into it, man. So it's not like it didn't happen for a reason. It's supposed to happen because you were in that. You know what I mean? But I feel like a lot of times it's hard to step into that, you know, and the hard part is the success of like, oh, damn, what if this does work? Like that's the scary part of like when you do crunch the numbers and you can see like, wait, I could do this, or like, wait, this could be even bigger. Then it's like, man, that's a lot of work.
Yeah. Fighting and scary.
Yeah. I don't know if I want this work. But to be able to step into that and own that is the power. You know what I mean? The glory. And that's why people come back. There's the chart.
Thank you.
What is it called, though? Because I can't pronounce that name. That ain't even in the vocab.
We're going to go ahead and throw that in the show notes.
We're going to throw that in the show notes.
I'm looking at that. I was like, I don't have that. I don't want to mess that up. So,
but yeah, no, when I saw this, it kind of blew my mind a little bit because of how simple it was, but how much sense that it made. And I was like, you know what? More people need to know about this. Like, and I feel like people do, but maybe they just never seen it. And when it hits you, you know?
Yeah, it gets right to it. It gets to the soul of the matter, man. And Ja, I keep seeing you keep having those same circles come back around, you know, and it seems like it leads you through some of these times, my man. So, okay, we picked that up. That's at 2017. You guys are just starting to move from the Harlem Hit side. When did JTW Fit actually start to take off?
So JTW Fits, we had a flood in that space on my birthday.
Okay.
February 15th, 2019. Wake up in the morning, amazing day, feeling good, get a call from my partner, cancel all the classes, the studio flooded.
Oof.
I'm like, here we go.
See, some people don't understand that there's some pros and cons that come with this entrepreneurial lifestyle, man. Yeah,
it's tough. You know, I'm dealing with all the things.
Yeah.
And I told my friends, I said, I might put together a little manual or write something, a little short story.
Exactly.
About this whole, it won't be a long one, but it'll give you enough to keep you motivated, but let you know it's not as easy as people think. A lot of people want to just take the leap and they don't have a plan and they're not really prepared for some of the stuff that happened. So flooding February, we were able to get a land of space in April. So build out, all that stuff that happened. We were able to have our opening late August and then we closed up again for a grand opening in September. So not, you know, a really quick turnaround. The space was amazing. So we get JCW Fit open. And kind of continuing where we left off, you know, first day, classes sold out, waitlist.
Wow.
So people were just kind of anticipating and waiting. And, you know, between that time, we were doing outdoor classes because it was obviously warmer. We were doing some stuff. We were renting out space at any gym that would have us, you know, just going to people's apartments, you know, whatever we could do to just kind of keep people motivated and not let them forget about us. But more so, they were like, whenever y'all come back, we ready. You know, we get it. This is unexpected. There's nothing you can do. So we were, you know, recording workouts and posting things for people to do at home, stuff like that. So then we get into JCW Fit and then we get 6 months of momentum, just getting it going. We're doing four classes a day, Monday through Saturday, just Olympic weightlifting, boxing, strength training, you know, sports conditioning, kettlebells, you name it, just trying to be a one-stop shop so people can come to. And then we were partner with some other gyms, Harlem Cycle,
yep.
You know, a few other spaces that were doing something a little bit different so people could have like a nice diverse week for themselves. You know, go here for cardio and dance, you know, go to Tamika for cycling, come here for strength work, just blend it all together. Then COVID hits, you know.
Yes.
And then COVID hits and that's March 2020. So I'm just at home, like, you know, flood. 6 months later, open. 6 months later, closed again. So it was weird because I'm like, I was, you know, to rewind, I'm seeing all the success. And remember, I said I was nervous and things are going really quickly. And I'm just like, and then boom, now things are, take it away. Come back, take it away. So I don't know if I, at home, yesterday I was like, you know, I think God was just like, we gave you enough and I'm pulling it back because I want to see how hungry you are. If you're still motivated to get back where you were and then take off. And so that's the kind of the mindset I'm taking now because I was devastated. I was depressed. Didn't want to be around anybody. Like I was going through it. But virtual programming became a huge success. Never done it before. Never talked to a camera. Never. I hate recording myself. I hate being on screen.
My bad, bro.
So
I feel bad about harassing you. Right?
All right. So then,
come now.
Now we're doing virtual program. So what motivated me there was we closed March 16th. That was a Tuesday. That Saturday, I already had figured out how to set up a virtual program. I got a Zoom account and just logged some stuff. I'm like, I'm going to try it out. Put a Saturday class up. 65 people signed up. And I was like, okay, like, I love y'all. Cause y'all, like, I'm ready to just quit. Like, this ain't for me. You know, maybe my time is up. I had a good window and 65 people signed up. And I was like, this is it. Okay. I think the best thing about it was because it was so new for me and new for them, I was allowed to make mistakes. It wasn't any pressure. I got feedback, you know, can you hear me? The audio, you know, the service and, you know, time on a spectrum, got to switch that up. So I was able to kind of just roll with the punches. And then we ended up having 21 classes a week. I was able to hire some coaches, you know, so now I got to create a couple jobs, you know, while everybody was kind of down and out, figuring out. That was like a dope thing. I was really happy about bringing a yoga instructor, Pilates, mobility. And again, just have another one-stop shop so people can, you know, just move, especially at home. For me, I was at home miserable. Like, I want to go lift my weights and, like, I'm active. I'm used to, like, being up on my feet all the time. And now I'm just sitting home watching Netflix and hanging out. I was like, I can only imagine what they feel like, you know, when they used to having somebody coaching them. So those are things that kept me motivated then. And then, you know, then came, like, on the back end became, like, the men's health stuff, which I'm sure we'll get to.
Yeah, man.
All that stuff is just like, all right, things are still happening. And, you know, in between there, I'm getting calls about doing virtual, like, corporate wellness stuff. So I'm like, okay, we still got something going. There's some momentum. People are still signing up. They still love the program. And then the biggest thing was I did a fundraiser for Harlem Hospital, essential workers. And I did a Zoom class with 122 people.
Wow.
Signed up, made a ton of money, donated lunch and just meals to Harlem Hospital essential workers. That was a big deal as well. Because I was like, all right, everybody always shows up for us in time of need. And if we ask them to support somebody else, they follow through. And I'm like, so this is like, the community is still here. And I'm like, you can't make this up. It's just a dope feeling.
Man, that's powerful, brother. Like, for real, powerful. Have to celebrate that on every single aspect of it. And, you know, you brought up the men's health side. And I do want to talk about how that whole process came about and what it meant to you. Like, you know, to be selected. Take me through that. So some of the listeners out there might not know and some of the viewers might not understand. I remember my first issues of men's health going all the way back to like me being in the first passes through this whole training situation, man. That was a magazine that I had to have in the locker all the time, bro. I had to keep it with me. Had to make sure I understand. Then I actually had a chance to work with Ev. I know what that magazine means. I know what that whole platform does to everybody. But, you know, when you get selected for something that, again, in the time frame that you're giving out, you're now, let's say, 5 years in, 3 to 5 years in that process,
yep,
somewhere around then. When you're selected as somebody who is the best out of that group of something that you just started on that side, that has to mean something different. That has to ring out a different way. Talk to me about, like, how that whole process.
So for those that don't know, so I was in a Facebook reality show. So Men's Health Next Top Trainer.
What's up, everyone? Ja Washington here from Men's Health, and we're going to be running through a lower body specific workout.
They picked 8 coaches out of apparently a couple thousand that they thought would just fit the bill in terms of what they were looking for. Social media presence, knowledge base, fun on camera, which I thought was kind of crazy. We'll get to that. and just like, you know, has, you know, just diverse in terms of like what they do, kettlebells, dumbbells, you know, things like that. And so a friend of mine she emailed me. She's like, hey, you should sign up for this. I was like, it's middle of a pandemic. I'm trying to keep my business alive. I don't got time for this. So I left it alone. She emails me back again a week later. She's like, if you never do anything else, just apply. Sign up, just apply. Like, okay, fine. So I apply. You know, I fill out the questionnaire, get a call back the next day. So I'm like, okay. So like, oh, you know, we read your answers. We really enjoyed what you had to say. We scrolled your social media page. They really like how you move and they like the stuff that you post. They want you to audition. Okay, fine. So they send me like, I have to record myself answering 10 questions. That took me 4 hours. Kid you not. In the studio by myself, 4 hours. Because I hate how I sound. I'm moving all over the place. This is about as calm as I've been in a long time on camera, right? So, you know, so now I record. I send it back. Like 2 months go by. So I'm thinking, all right, fine. Well, I applied. Bridge underwater. I'm home, coming home one night, having a rough day. 9 p.m., get a call before I get on the elevator. Hey, you know, this is talent such and such from Men's Health. You were selected. We start shooting next week. Are you still interested? So I'm like, oh, okay. Sure. I'm good. You know, I had to motivate myself again because I was over it already. Like,
Let's do that.
So I get upstairs, telling my girl, like, oh, Steph, we shoot next week. She's like, what? I'm like, we shoot next week. She's like, you doing it? I'm like, I can't say nope. Gotta do it. But so fast forward, we start shooting. I win the first episode. So now I'm confused. I'm like, okay, this is real. So I start, you know, I'm a planner. So I see who all the guys are that I'm going against. I done looked up their social media. I'm scrolling everybody's page, just figuring out who they are, what they do, just trying to get ahead of the competition. If I'm in it, I'm in it.
Yeah, you're going to compete. Damn it.
I'm in it. Y'all want to compete?
Now it's a game.
So I win episode one. I come in second place episode two. Win episode three. Lose episode four. But like I'm killing it, right? So now I'm like, okay. This is feeling good. I'm getting excited. And they end up winning the whole thing. You know, just fast forward. Win the whole thing. And the most important part about that was I had so much other stuff going on. And that was like just something I could focus on and just lock in. And it put everything else on the back burner for a second. And it was also very important to, like, I always kept my community, kept all the clients updated. Like, even though all this stuff is going on, like, I'm still managing to support y'all. We still getting in shape. I'm about to win this. You know, this is for Harlem. This is for us.
Like, put the
I'm
team on the out. Back. You ready to go.
I'm going to win this. Yeah. And like, you know, so that was like just motivation for them. They were like, if he can do all this stuff and still manage to like keep this together, you know, everybody's pushing now. Everybody's working a little bit harder. I've got weight loss challenges and all this stuff going on all at the same time. People losing weight. So it was just a dope experience because people fed off of it. Like, it was just a fire. And then, you know, to win it, it was just a big deal. Because one is obviously, you know, my name is Joaquin Washington. I'm from Harlem, you know. So, yeah, I'm sure ain't nobody from Harlem ever been in Men's Health magazine.
Come on. Right?
I'm sure most people in Harlem don't even read Men's Health magazine.
But
quite frankly.
I'm so a guarantee you, when you was in there, they had a couple bumps on that subscription over on that side.
It was a big deal to represent. And then seeing people in the community, like, oh, I saw you in the magazine.
Exactly.
Like, all of that stuff just felt really good because I know how hard I work. You know, I don't talk about it all the time, but like, I'm just like, I know I work hard and I'm consistent and I'm always going to show up. And so having these things happen, again, still surprising, but I know my intention, my effort is there. So I expect like something to happen at some point. But like, again, like I said, a lot of this stuff, it just consistently just been, wow, this is happening. This is happening. So sometimes I get caught up in when is the, you know, is it something negative that's coming up? You know, and I try to stay away from that though.
That's a thought that can end up taking away the joy of the moment from you for sometimes, you know, and I only identify with it because I've suffered from having that same thing too. You got to learn to ride. You talked about the ebb and flow that keeps coming back in. Like you make some progress and then you see some stuff recede, right? It's kind of like literally like the ocean.
Yep.
See it push out and pull back in, push out, pull back in. And, you know, the career that you're sharing with us on this side is showing that, okay, you made some advancements and then nobody would have been able to tell you that all gyms would be closed for 6 months point in time. You know, you make some more advancements even before that. Oh, nobody would have been able to tell you that your whole basement was going to flood or any of that kind of stuff. You know, then you get all of these things that test you, and perseverance is something that I keep seeing has to be one of the hallmarks that I'm getting from your story right here. You know, there's a determination and perseverance. Who would you say influenced you and helped you come to that type of mindset? Where'd you get that from?
I got three people. My mom, for sure. You know, just in very general, she's figured it out, right? My father passed early. when I was 9, and she's always been there. She's always figured it out. We've never been hungry, always have clothes. Christmas, holidays, figured out. We always had things that we wanted. And so, and I never asked questions, and I always saw her. She sacrificed a lot, you know, and we can talk about it now that I'm older. A lot of things that she probably wanted to do, she didn't get to do because she was like, I got to make sure we're good. And so that's motivation always. You know, I look at all the sacrifices she made to make sure that I could be successful. So that's one. My sister has been like my role model forever. You know, she's the books, the brainiac in the family, you know, boarding school, Cornell, Duke graduate, you know, director of, you know, hospitals in Georgia right now. Like she's always had like regimented and I'm doing this and it happens. So I take some of that from her. If I say I'm going to do something, you got to do it, right? Look somebody in the eyes, you got to do it. So I take some of that stuff from her. And then third would be my high school basketball coach. I was never a street kid, but I hung out with everybody. I knew everybody, but like I was never a street kid, but he made sure that I never took a turn. From basketball, it was bigger than basketball. We had study hall. We did community service, made sure that we got into college. I went to college for free, right? That's a huge deal, you know, especially coming out of school and you have no debt. He made sure, he's like, I don't care if you never go pro, you never make it NBA, you don't go overseas, you're going to be intelligent, people are going to respect you, and like you're going to make something of yourself. And that was like a father figure for a lot of me and the whole school, honestly, and all my teammates. So those three people combined, you know, all in the same time frame with me as I'm figuring out who I am, like it was the best combination of people I could have that were there and consistent. And that's the big thing, is consistent, not popping in and out, checking when they feel like it. Just like he was there, he's still there, you know. The men's health stuff, got a text message from him, get a phone call, you know. And so for that, like I've always been, that's why I always go back to my school to talk to the students, to talk to the teams, talk to the players, and just make sure that like, you know, this guy knows what he's talking about. You, if there's anybody in this school you listen to, it should be him, because he's always going to guide you. He has your best interests at heart and he wants nothing from it. He just wants you to be successful. So, you know, those three has been just... And now, you know, everyone around me that's just doing great things, like my community, the people who come to the studio, all super successful, all grinders, all supporting each other, helping each other get jobs. It's a lot more going on than fitness right now, networking, things like that. And that keeps me motivated, too, because I'm like, OK, we've built something that people actually want to be a part of. And they're really supporting each other in, you know, outside of this, let's get in shape and build some muscle and all that stuff.
Yeah, that's just the thing that brought people to the party. I could see that from very early into the, you know, early into your conversation about how you're describing you just having stewardship for a real community. You know, what got them there versus why they decided to stay and why they decided to keep returning. It's your energy, your effort, and the work that you've been putting into that same side, man. So I'm just grateful for you to even share that. Okay, that started back with you having a positive mentor. And then, you know, there's a part of you that is doing that for the people that you keep sending back to, you know. So we talked about the importance of refilling your cup, you know, before we actually jumped down into having a conversation. Could you go into a little bit about how you do, you know, replenish after being in service of this many people, like, you know, and after, you know, tending to a full community? Like, when do you turn back in and be like, all right, this is what I got to do for Ja right now?
So I never used to do that. I was on 24/7.
Yeah.
Just on. Even when I get home and the work is like I'm done with sessions, I'm still texting with clients and like, you know, checking in. Emails. Some of that stuff, you know, it took a toll on my relationship with my girl, took a toll on my relationship with my family. I just wasn't doing the things that I love doing, you know, just turn the television on, you know, playing some video games, like all those like things just to just relax for a second was non-existent. And something I learned is that, and I've been saying this over and over to people now, stress is not always tied to negative things. Right? If you're passionate about something, you're really into it, you're giving it your all, that's stress as well, because you always want to do the right thing and be successful and continue to grow and build. And so I was stressed out for good reasons, you know, outside of like, you know, obviously life hits you hard with all the closing and things like that with COVID. But in general, everything that I was doing, I love it. And I was like, I gotta find a way to take some time for myself. And I still wasn't able to figure it out, but I started therapy. And that's something that I wasn't necessarily against growing up, but I was like, I just don't need it. And figured out, oh, you definitely need it.
How many of us, man? Stay with that.
Definitely need it.
Yeah.
And and you need a lot of it. And I was like, okay, I'm doing once a week. And then, you know, me and my girl, we did some couples therapy too. I'm like, you know, let's figure it all out while we're here. And best thing I ever did, man, was just to sit and talk to somebody and, you know, bounce ideas and really just have conversations. And I didn't realize how much stuff I was holding on to, because I'm like, I just gotta next play, next play, next play. And never really owning my feelings, not talking about it with anybody, just leaving stuff and just letting it boil over. Like, you know, and then it just grows. And now you're upset for no reason. You don't even know why you're mad. You're just depressed and you don't know why. And so therapy was like number one thing. And then in the last 3 months, you know, my girl and I, we just, you know, took some time off. I went to see family. I saw some friends I haven't been able to check on in a while. We went to a wedding, went to Mexico, you know, just bounced around with the Houston. And I'm like, every time that I got off the plane, before I even got into any fun or anything like that, I was like, ooh, this just felt good to just be somewhere else. And I'm like, okay, I need to get out of here more often. Like,
yeah.
I need to get out of here more often. So now for me, game planning for the future is I can't be as present in the studio. I can't train 15 sessions a week anymore. Like, I just can't do that. And I need to figure out a way to start hiring, bring in a nice staff, people who, you know, believe in us, who believe in the brand, believe in the mission, are here for the right reasons, and like start to help people grow and coach and build that so that I can actually dial back and, you know, be present for a lot more than just this exercise stuff. So
as you speak, man, so many things come to mind, but I'm thinking about intention and effort were two things that you brought up before. Like, you're very intentional with what you want, and the effort that you put in is shown over time, man. And I get the idea that you aren't easily impressed. So even when Men's Health came along, like, oh, this is cool, you know what I mean? I can do it. And then, like, you end up winning, you know what I mean? Like, that is, to Tony's point, that energy that you have, that you put out, man, it not wanting anything attracts everything. You know what I mean? Like, it just, again, that universal alignment, it just kind of keeps flowing in, man. And as wellness professionals, a lot of time when you provide so much to so many people, like, you never take that you time, man. And like, something as simple as literally leaving the city you're from is a life change. It's like,
bro,
oh,
I remember when we had that conversation on the damn stairs. I was like, fam,
yep,
just take that wherever you need to go. Take this time, man.
Right.
I'm happy to see it.
It makes such a difference, because when you step outside of your comfort zone, you get to see how other people live. You get to see, like, oh, wow, like, I'm really busting my ass, and ain't nobody else really doing it how I'm doing it right here. You know, it's eye-opening, and you don't know how hard you're working until you see the other work that people aren't doing, until you can go places and pinpoint it out and be like, well, I would have did this that way. I would have did that way. I would have, you're like, oh, damn, I'm doing it. You know what I mean? And I'm living it. So I just want to take this time to champion you for that, man, and to continue to keep that energy so that more people can see that it exists. You know, like, oftentimes we just don't believe it until you see it. You know what I mean? Especially being in Harlem and Uptown.
Just cleaned my fancy car, picked up my fancy clothes. Every owner in the house, but I know we got the ball, we got the ball. This is Spur Gang money. This is Spur Gang money.
Every hood, every ghetto got the same setup, same concept, you know. So until you can see that light, that vision, that person that's doing something, you're never really going to believe it. It's like, I don't believe this dude, man. He ain't about that life, you know. But to actually see it, to feel it, to hear it, to smell it, like, to get all the senses involved, man, it's a beautiful thing, man. So I just want to continue to give you these flowers, man, because I see it from the people that I know that know you, like, through the wellness community. Like, the deeper you get into it, the smaller the community is, right? Truly.
Damn,
you know,
sure.
Yep. You know, you know one person. Oh, yeah, I know him. And then
we'd be one person removed the whole time.
One person removed the whole time, but we all are on that same mission, that collective mission to bring health and wellness to the community. So anytime that we can get somebody in this seat that is doing that, man, we gotta celebrate you, though, like, for real, and in no small way. Like, you're changing lives, bro. Like, you mentioned two people that, you know, lost the weight. That was the 90 pounds and the 60 pounds. But like, day to day, like, you changing lives and inspiring people, man. So you gotta continue to go with that.
Talk to us a little bit about the next chapter, brother. Like, what would you say success means going forward for you as an individual, for the brand, you know, and maybe some of the stuff that you want to be aspirational with the community?
So I'm still involved with men's health. So that's something. We got some projects that are coming up. We'll talk to Ebenezer in the upcoming week. So
yeah, shout out to Ebenezer. What up?
We have a couple different programs they have me doing. Right now, I'm studying for my CSCS, so Certified Strength and Conditioning Specialist.
Yes, sir.
Shout out to Eb again. Because I won, they're supporting me on the education tip. So
he's
like, we're going to make sure you get this so it can open some more doors.
For the layperson, that's the top of the top.
That is.
Certification that you need.
That's one of the harder.
60% fail rate.
Yeah, I was going to say, that was one of the harder classes I had to take in school, man.
For sure.
So I'm locked in on that now. As soon as I got back from my trips, that's been the focus right now. Couple of personal training sessions here and there. We've been talking about reopening another JTW Fit studio. Kind of got that on the back burners for now. Just trying to figure out where, pricing, location, you know how that gets with real estate and stuff like that.
Physical space is still a little tricky.
It's tough. It's tricky. And now, you know, with not COVID being over, but the city opening back up, now prices are jumping back up.
Yeah.
Trying to take advantage of, like, you know, this little market that might be there. Outside of that, I have a project I'm working on. It's actually not public, but we're going to talk about it today anyway.
Hey, we got an exclusive? That's what's up.
So right now I'm working on, so we talked about kettlebells, right? I've found a passion for those. I love using them. It's one of my favorite tools. And I've got a big community that actually enjoys them as well.
You better believe
it. Really uptown that's into it the way I am, or using them properly, right? So what I'm working on now is I'm working on opening my own, like a smaller studio, like a side project. And I think it's going to be a big deal, but it'll be Harlem Kettlebell Club.
Woof.
So it'll be strictly kettlebell strength and conditioning, only kettlebells and body weight, right? We're not bringing in dumbbells, bar, but if you want to learn kettlebells, you want to be proficient, you want to learn how to use these, this is all we're doing. So I'm working on, been looking at spaces, locations. You know, I don't need a ton of space, but I need some. We're going rubber floor it, music on, bells, some chalk.
Ready to go.
And get after it. And I think that's going to be something huge. I don't know. I haven't personally seen any kettlebell-specific studios. I've been doing a little bit of research. I haven't seen them. They probably do exist. But obviously, there's nothing uptown. And I'm somebody who's like, I'd rather create it, wait for somebody else to bring it.
Hell
so
yeah.
That'll be a smaller project that doesn't call for a lot on the financial tip, but I can get something going. And with that, I want to have group fitness. I want to have some individualized attention. I would like to hire. So I want to create jobs and have some kettlebell coaches. People who are been in the game for a while and know what they're doing, and then some people who are up and coming and really want to learn. And then I also want to partner with some organizations that certify, so have them come and host their certifications there, again, to help coaches, even people, you know, general population that just want to learn. That could be another aspect, and then just kind of create that dynamic in that community uptown.
Man, I haven't used them in a long time, but it was strong first, RKC, when they first came through the first wave of that stuff. Some people out there, the layperson, Ja, they might not understand why this kettlebell is your preferred tool in this whole repertoire, and why you would even start a whole small subdivision of your business with that. Can you break out for people why that tool in particular is the one that you want to focus on?
So my first time in the gym using it was an accident. Came in 5 p.m., 6 p.m., worst time to ever go to the gym. Right? I had my whole program set up.
Prime time right there.
You know, can't use nothing in here.
I'm like, I'm going to get a rack. I got to get a rack. Right?
Hell
no.
There.
No squat racks. When I tell you, blink, all the dumbbells were off the racks.
Oh,
it was a madhouse. So I'm looking around like, I need to do something. I'm here. You know, I took a little pre-workout that day, so I'm already charged.
I'm already ready.
So kettlebells are sitting there. No one ever touches them. The whole rack is full. Not a lot of them, but none of them are touched. All right, squat, do some rows. I'm doing like basic stuff, but I kind of enjoy these. Why nobody use them? And I got curious and I started messing around with them a little bit more. So on the back end of my sessions, I would just go play around with them. So I was looking up some videos on my own. I was like, you know what? Maybe I'll just get a certification, right? No one's doing this. I feel like everybody's doing, you know, everybody's boxing. Everyone's barbell, dumbbell, right? Dumbbell standard. I'm going to just get a certification, just try to learn this and just add it to my package, right? And just build. This would be my thing. Not knowing that I would actually like end up wanting to just use them all the time, but I was like, I just wanted to have it in the back pocket. So I started teaching a class in studio, very basic. We weren't even doing clean swings, snatches, none of that. I was using it as like a dumbbell.
Yeah.
So weight. But come virtual programming, I'm like, okay, well, now I want to figure out how to make this a little more spicy and want people to sign up. So I may just try a kettlebell class. So I rented, me and my partner, we rented all of our dumbbells, kettlebells, everything in the studio to our members. Because they didn't have stuff at home. And then obviously, like, I don't know, you guys know weights and stuff are hard to come by.
In the middle of quarantine?
Rented everything, emptied out the studio, set up times for them to come. And then I started a kettlebell class virtually, which is also tough because I'm like, I don't even know how I'm going to teach this through a screen.
Yeah.
But I got so good at it through a screen. I'm like, I have to like do this in person because now I can actually really hands-on correct form and like help you get better. So everyone, that class blew up virtually. You know, I was doing that 2-3 times a week. Started doing some outdoor stuff when it got warm. You know, I think to fast forward, it's a simple tool. You can use it for all your basic strength training work. You can get advanced with it in terms of like cleans, swings, and snatches. Those are more advanced movements. I think if you're someone who is getting into strength training and don't really want to put a bar on your back and don't feel comfortable, it's just a way to go in a corner. You don't need a lot of space. And again, you can be really efficient as long as you're having your intentions are there and you're working really hard. And so that's, you know, in terms of how I approach this is I want people to go into the gym and feel confident with any tool and be able to go in and like, okay, I know how to squat with this, row with this, press with this. I'm good. Squat rack isn't available, same way it was for me. No problem. I'm getting in here and I'm figuring it out. So I think that's like the main thing. And it's also just dope. Like everybody, it's nice. No one knows, like not a lot of people uptown know how to do clean swings, snatches, rotate and have fun with the bells. And so they just, I'm like, you're going to look cool as shit when you go to the gym.
Man, yo, bro, I know you messed up a couple people days. I seen you doing the offside press one time with him. I was like, yo, there's a dude behind you. It was just like, yeah, I'm just going to go home today. I'm just going to go ahead and pack
up. I ain't got it.
You break out the bells and blink, they might kick you out sometimes.
That's not welcome here, man. But man, we could chop it up for days. But, you know, as the sun sets, Tony,
okay,
and the night falls.
Okay.
You know, we got to ask, what's some advice that you could give the listener, right, to follow that passion, right, to do what it is they feel called to do, if it's entrepreneurial, if it's weight training, if it's a kettlebell, like what could you tell the person out there to get them started?
Well, I think the first thing is in anything, right, just have a plan, right? Just have, it doesn't have to be concrete, but just have some things in mind that you want to do. If you're looking to become an entrepreneur, you know, set some things down, do some number crunching, figure out, can I actually do this? Do I need to wait? But like, don't be afraid to take that leap, right? I would never tell somebody just quit without knowing like what's going on. You know, that's where things get tricky. You know, my situation, I was younger, I had no kids, not married. I have nothing else going on. So like, you can take those kind of leaps. If you're in a different situation, you really got to, you know, assess where you are. But again, don't be afraid to do it if you're going to do it. Because I think if your energy and passion is there and you're really going to go for it, some good things will happen. I think the other thing is, you know, if you're someone who's looking to get into wellness and fitness, start small. You know, don't write out this 6-12 month program, right? Or this goal. Keep it really small. 2 weeks. What can I do in this month? I think when you have those consistencies and you see those small wins, the bigger picture feels closer. Big L. All right, you want to lose 100 pounds? Great. How many are you going to lose this week? You know, when you make those things smaller and attainable and you allow yourself things that you can actually achieve, right? It can be super small, but if you can mark it every day, it's just consistency. And I think that's the biggest thing is consistency. It can be whatever it is for you. If it's 2 times a week is your consistency, then do 2 times a week because over a 12-month period, you can say that you stuck to something. And I think we all have a hard time sticking to our plans and saying, this is what I'm doing and continuing with it. So that's the most important piece.
Man, Ja, I know there's going to be a lot of people inspired by this conversation, brother. I know they're going to have to come through and check out one of these boot camp classes because I don't know if you've been paying attention, folks. This man is doing them up and it's looking like it's getting spicy outside. You know what I mean? Can you let the good people know? And it's, you know what? Even reel it back, we've been talking to these WTF folks over here and they've been looking for some fitness tips and tricks. And I've been telling them, we good anywhere that they got a damn pull-up bar. But I'm trying to tell you right now, when I say creme de la motherfucking creme, top. This man's right here. Can you let these people know where they could come and get the smoke when they need it?
Now, we're obviously uptown in Harlem. If you want to reach out to me directly, I'm a big Instagram person. So my page is JAH_HOLLA. Business page is at JTWFit. And if you're really into the kettlebells, right, that's on the way. We're going to have Harlem Kettlebell Club on Instagram as well. So a lot of dope things coming up. You know, we're just putting it together, getting organized, but It's going to be fun. It's going to be great energy. It's no egos. We just like to have fun and we get in shape at the same time.
Man.
Yeah, like yay.
My kind of spot, man. I can't wait to pull up the swings. But as soon as I get this leg situated, bro, right back in there.
We're going
to
have you single leg swinging.
I'm
man.
Right in here. I'm ready to go right into the windmill just on the one side. Just give it to me one time, John. I'm ready for it. Ready to jump back in the game, coach. Put me in.
Yeah, we're going
to
get you some breakaway pants. You know? And with that being said,
it's been another fantastic episode of Off the Strength. I'm a trainer called Tony.
K.R. Jones.
Peace and much love out there to y'all. Until next time, we'll see you soon.
Peace.
What's good, everybody? I'm a trainer called Tony, and I am here from the infamous Off the Strength podcast, asking you today, listeners, viewers, wherever you may be, to please like, listen, and subscribe to our podcast. This is how we're going to continue to be able to deliver you the best goddamn wellness information out here. So if you want to keep hearing this and you want us to keep growing, you are a part of this show just as much as anything else. So please go to offthestrength.com. Make sure you check out our blogs. Make sure you check us out on IG. And if you're hearing this voice and you didn't hit that subscribe button, know that Kyle is going to come looking for you.
You got that right.